I have a few people ask me about buying the first knitting machine. The question usually is, how can I pick the best knitting machine for myself? Well, there is no one-size-fits-all answer to this because our expectations on knitting machines are different. It depends on a few different factors, including what you want to make on the knitting machine and how much time and money you are willing to invest into it. There are a lot of knitting machines out there, and you probably have seen something like this, or this, maybe this one, or even this one. If you don't know a lot about knitting machines, the process of buying your first one can be very overwhelming. In this video, I'm going to lay out some ideas on how to decide which type of knitting machines may work best for you. Now, a beginner machine may work best for one person, but not the other. Your friend's dream machine may have all the features you like, but it may not fit into your budget. You should do your own research and a great deal of thinking before buying a knitting machine for yourself. Speaking of budget, it should be one of the biggest considerations. We all have a budget, but the question is the budget fixed or flexible? Let's hope we have a bit flexibility when we find something we really like. If not, we should try to stay within our budget, or all the time and effort in looking for a knitting machine will be fruitless. Once you have your budget sorted out, the first thing I recommend to do is to decide what type of features you want for your knitting machine. This will base on what you want to make with your knitting machine. All knitting machines do the same thing, to allow you to knit with multiple needles at the same time to speed up the process. Some of them have more advanced features while others are just plain knitters. Some machines come in bigger gauge to accommodate thicker yarns, while other machines can handle very fine yarns. Now, think. What would you most likely be making if you have a knitting machine? You may have a lot of ideas in your head, but in reality, there is no one machine that can handle all of your projects. The key is to pick one gauge that will suit most of your projects, in order to make the best of your knitting machine. What is a gauge? A gauge is the difference between the two adjacent needles, usually measured in millimeters. The larger the gauge, the thicker the yarn the machine can take. It will be difficult to use thick yarns on a fine gauge machine or the other way around. There are different gauges, and here are some very common ones. A fine gauge is 3.6 millimeters. A standard gauge is 4.5 millimeters. And there are some knitting machines come in 5 millimeter gauge, while the mid gauge is between 6 and 6.5 millimeters. Bigger than that are some of the bond knitting machines. Most of these bonds are in 8 millimeter gauge, except for one that is 7 millimeters. The chunky or bulky gauge is 9 millimeters. There are some odd gauges out there, but I will be covering just these few for now. The biggest gauge I've ever heard of is 11 millimeters, but I have not seen one in person. The gauge of the machine dictates what you can make, so choose carefully. If you want to make very soft baby clothes or socks, a fine gauge machine will fit the bill. The standard 4.5 millimeters and the 5 millimeter machines will handle 2 to 4 pline yarns rather nicely. The mid gauge machines can take hand knitters' favorite yarns without compromise. If you're all into very chunky yarns to make jackets and something requires a lot of structures, a bulky machine will fit you very well. The next thing you should consider is a ribber. Some machines come with a ribber, while others are just plain single beds. There are pros and cons about buying a double bed machine or a single bed machine to start. A ribber is a full-size attachment to your knitting machine. It looks very much like your knitting machine with the same number of needles and its own carriage. Having a ribber allows you to make ribbings, tubular knittings. It can expand the capacity of your existing knitting machine. A machine comes without a ribber is called a single bit, while the machine comes with a ribber is called a double bit. While some single bits have the capacity to pair it with a ribber, some don't. The machines built as double bits are much heavier and bigger because you cannot remove the ribber for storage or shipping. The pros of buying a single bit, especially if you buy one with ribber potential, is that it's cheaper to store it, it's smaller, and more portable. You can do mock ribbings using just a single bit. It's more work, but it's less professional looking. The cons of buying the knitting machine and the ribber separately is that it usually will cost more than buying them together. The pros of buying a double bit is that the ribber will give you more advantages as you become a more experienced machine knitter. Some of the European double bed machines have far more features offered from the start. On the other hand, the ribber of these machines are fixed to the main bed, therefore not very portable. People with double bed machines almost always have the machines left out because packing and storing them away are just too much work and troubles. Very likely, you will need to have a permanent spot for it. And of course, since it's coming with a ribber, the investment is usually a bit higher than buying just a main knitting bed. Another feature you want to consider is the patterning capacity of a knitting machine. Some older machines are plain knitters. They can do the basic stocking stitch or stocking knit. You still can make patterns by doing needle manipulations. This means you move specific needles row by row to form specific patterns on your knitting. It's time-consuming, but it's doable. A plain knitter is best for someone who doesn't care about patterns or doesn't mind doing needle manipulations. If you want to make patterns quickly, you may want a machine that does patterning for you. There are a few options. A punch card can be used in a machine with a punch card reader. Of course, we call those machines punch card machines. Here is what a punch card looks like. Some machines, instead of using a punch card, they use an electronic reader to read something called a Mylar sheet. The concept is very much like a punch card. The electronic reader is one step above a punch card reader because it has greater capacity in controlling the size and proportion when patterning. They are usually a bit more expensive than the punch card machines. Here is what a Mylar sheet looks like. The newer knitting machines, especially those are built as double beds like a passive, come with even more advanced electronic device. Not only it can read patterns, it allows you to design your own patterns, even guides you along when you need to shape your garments. Some newer single bed machines have the capacity to use such a device, but you will have to buy them separately. Now remember, the more bells and whistles a machine has, the more expensive it usually is. You will have to keep the balance between the budget and features to make the best of your purchase. I have covered the basic features that you need to consider when buying your first knitting machine. There are also other considerations that are worth giving them some thoughts to. Some machines are made of mostly metal, while others are mostly plastic. Like everything else, there are always pros and cons of each of them. A metal bed machine is usually sturdier and heavier, also with more needles. Metal beds usually have greater potential when it comes to add-ons. This means you can add other attachments to make your machine more versatile. You'll find most metal beds with gauges from 3.6 millimeters to 5 millimeters. Then The metal bulky machines is 9 millimeters. The downside of a metal bed is that it's usually more expensive and gauge specific. The smaller gauge of metal machines usually require cone yarns, and cone yarns are rarely available in regular yarn stores. You need to buy them from a dealer or a store that sells needle machine yarns, and they tend to be more expensive. You can wind a skein yarn as long as the size is correct, but then you will have to purchase a yarn winder for that purpose. A plastic machine is usually smaller and more portable, with less needles on the bit. Some of the newer ones do have the capacity for some add-ons, but most still don't. On average, they are a little cheaper than metal beds. The upside of a plastic bed is that most of them fall into the middle range of yarn size, the gauge between 6 and 9 millimeters, so they are more forgiving if you want to use hand-knitted yarns. There are a few plastic beds in the market that will allow you to use skein yarns, but most of the more advanced plastic beds still require the yarn to be wound into the ball for tension control. In that case, you will still need to buy a yarn winder. Another consideration is the age of the machine. Do you want to buy a brand new one or a vintage one? Unless you go to a dealer to look for a brand new machine, chances are you will see most vintage machines in the market. European machines were built like tanks, almost indestructible. The vintage Japanese machines are also built to last. I personally love vintage machines simply because I'm sure of the quality. The downside of buying a very old machine is that you may have a hard time finding replacement parts for it. So, if you want to buy the vintage machine, look around to see if there are other machines similar. If so, there are very good chance you can buy parts and accessories for it. If the machine you're looking at is the only machine you can find on the internet, don't hold your breath for add-ons and possible replacements. A little diligence will go a long way. I don't know how many knitting machine names are still being produced these days. I know there are at least two of them. They are both Japanese style, still in production. When I say Japanese style, I mean they look similar to the old Japanese machines, but they are manufactured in China. I don't have first-hand experience with these Chinese machines, but my personal preference is buying vintage because that's what I know and that's what I like.